Hello, I guess we can start. Thank you everybody for coming to this session. This panel is dedicated to the issue of government-sponsored hacking in Russia and beyond, in the region and against targets outside Russia, but that have connection with the Russian government. We have here several people who can explain how it works in the first place on the ground, because these people, including myself, have been targeted by this hacking long before it made headlines around the world. And we also have several experts who have looked into these cases, helping activists and journalists in Russia and in the region cope with the attacks. So starting from the left, we have Ruslan Leviev, who is an investigative journalist in Russia and is the leader of conflict intelligence team, and they investigate Russia's involvement, secret involvement in armed conflicts in different parts of the world. We have then Eva Galperin, who is the director for cybersecurity at EFF. We have Roman Dobrokhodov, who is the editor-in-chief of The Insider, a Russian media outlet. And we have Vadim Losev, who is the Eurasia lead at, did I just open some secret at ISC project? Is that so? Yeah. Okay, and myself, I am Oleg Kozlovsky. I'm a Russian activist based in Moscow and director of Vision of Tomorrow Foundation. So I will abuse my moderator rights to start this discussion by telling my story. My Telegram account was hacked a year ago, and to the best of my knowledge, it was the first well-documented and successful attack against Telegram, and it was also one of the most sophisticated ones because it used my cell phone operator, one of the leading mobile phone operators in Russia, MTS, which played a very important role in the attack, because it started with my mobile phone having its SMS service and internet, mobile internet access disabled, which was several minutes later followed by the attack itself. So somebody used Tor to connect a new device to my Telegram account. They intercepted the SMS with the code, activation code for Telegram, and I didn't receive that code because my SMS service was disabled. And after apparently downloading all the information they needed, they again restored all the services for my mobile phone, and this attack could be left completely unnoticed unless Telegram sent a separate message to my Telegram account informing me of a new device being connected, and this message could not be removed from the new device. So this is how I learned in the morning that I had the security breach. At the same time, simultaneously, another activist had a similar attack. And our problem, of course, was that we hadn't enabled two-factor authentication, which had been introduced several months later, several months earlier in Telegram. So the fact that somebody used a mobile phone operator to organize this attack points probably to the Russian government, which alone has such a coercive power to force a big company to do this, and also the lack of any investigation on the part of the government or on the part of MTS of this incident also shows that probably it was not some rogue party hacking MTS in order to hack me. And I would like to start with Roman to ask you, since your media works a lot with sensitive issues such as corruption, such as secret services in Russia, and other stuff that is considered very politically sensitive. Tell us, how have you been targeted, and what can you tell us from this experience?
Yes, I'll tell a little bit about my personal experience, both by experience as journalist and experience as activist, because I have also a long story of being attacked before it was cool. So, but at first, I would try to put you in some context, because many some of you maybe don't know about what hackers we are speaking about. So. We know at least about two groups of state-sponsored hackers in Russia. It's so-called Fancy Bear, or APT-28, and Cozy Bear, also known as APT-29. They are both very professional. They both have very big and experienced teams. Fancy Bear acts at least from 2008, or maybe a little bit since earlier times. Cozy Bear started somewhere around 2010, so they both have pretty big experience of attacking different targets both inside country and outside country. We know well that all of the targets, they're interesting for the Kremlin, so they are kind of enemies of the Kremlin. They can be both activists, journalists inside the country, or some governmental bodies of foreign countries, or that can be military targets, or sometimes also media or political parties, like in USA. They use a little bit different tools. I would not go deep inside that, but we know that they work independently from each other. Sometimes they attack the same aims, but without even knowing that the other group works at the same target. My personal experience is connected with Fancy Bear, so I'll take more about that. The last, maybe the most interesting part of it was is concerned about the attack that was in October of last year, when there was a big wave of phishing attacks on dozens of Russian activists, journalists, NGO representatives. They all had letters in Gmail where, the letters that seemed to be letters sent by Gmail telling them that their accounts are hacked and they need to change their password. And if you would be very attentively and see in an address line, you would see that this not a gmail.com, but gmail.mail.com or something like this. And especially it is easy to miss it if you watch it from a mobile phone when you don't see this address line. So, of course, I already knew about this practice, so I resend these letters to five cybersecurity organizations, different five cybersecurity organizations. All of them independently analyzed these phishing emails, and all of them independently told me that this is definitely Fancy Bear phishing emails. Then also I got a lot from Google that I am object of a state-sponsored hacker attack. And that's pretty interesting, because that gives us some evidence not only about me, but also about other targets. So when Donald Trump says that there can be some fat guy that's sitting on his sofa and attacking Democratic Party, that means that for some strange reason, the same fat guy that's sitting on a sofa also attacking me, Oleg, and other people, And also, Gmail says that he's a state-sponsored Fed guy. And there are actually a lot of these Fed guys, because we know that there are a lot of people who are working for some reason by working hours of Moscow time zone. So this Fed guy, either he works at nights or he sits somewhere near us in Moscow time zone. And also these attacks are actually very expensive. So this must be a very rich Fed guy. And also with some reason he attacks only those targets that are interesting for the Kremlin. Both Russian oppositioners or some, I don't know, State Department of USA or some political parties that are not loyal to the Kremlin, and so on and so on. So that all gives us some picture that's maybe not 100% proof, but gives us some hint of who may be responsible. And the last thing I wanted to say, that that is not only classical attacks when you got phishing emails and you just put the link, though this is the most likely ones. But sometimes there were attacks that we detected in 2010, so pretty a long time ago, when we even didn't know how it happened, but we know that in Solidarnost movement, that is kind of a coalition of different oppositional activists, that some of our activists saw that emails are redirected to some unknown address. And I asked all of my partners to check their emails, and they see some of them saw suddenly that their emails are redirected, and maybe they have been redirected for several years and they even didn't know about it. That means that these guys, they just don't not only want to get this information, but they all want to be kind of persistent watchers who gather this information, so they don't need a spy inside the organization. They just need some source inside that gets it and then transfer to some more high-ranking Fed guys. So that's my part.
Thank you, Roman. Ruslan, your organization has exposed Kremlin's involvement in military conflicts on more than one occasion, which we may think have infuriated quite a few people out there. And I know that you have faced attacks that were quite unlike those that Roman and myself have mentioned. Can you tell us what these attacks were like?
Hello, my name is Ruslan Lviv. I'm from Conflict Intelligence Team. Over the last 3 years, our team has been investigating military conflicts in which Russia is involved. This is Syria and Ukraine. Of course, our activities arouse dissatisfaction among the Russian authorities. Twice they tried to open a criminal case against me. Once I was at the military prosecutor's office for questioning. Sometimes I noticing shadowing or the wiretapping. And in February 2016, we prepared a large investigation in which the Russian Minister of Defense was personally exposed. We found a photograph of him awarding a wounded soldier in Moscow for fighting in Debaltseve. Debaltseve is a town in which is located in Donbas region in Ukraine. When the day before the publication, I announced publicly announced that our investigation, in which Russian Minister of Defense personally appeared, will soon be published. In the middle of the next night, while I was sitting at home and working, I suddenly started receiving SMS messages with two-factor authentication codes from Facebook and Twitter. I realized that somebody trying to hack me. I started to check in my profiles on social networks and saw that they failed to break my Facebook and Twitter accounts. Also, I checked my primary email address, which is located on the Gmail mail servers, and found that they failed to break my primary email address. Then I started to change all the passwords and in all my accounts, and saw that they successfully hacked my old mailbox, which is located on the Russian service Yandex.ru. Well, I don't know how exactly they hacked my old mailbox, but I suppose they used a direct access to Yandex servers because I have a long and complex password there, as well as two-factor authentication tied to my cell number. I suppose they has a strong connection with the Federal Security Service, so sometimes they can get direct access to service which is located in Russia. In my old mailbox, they found my login and password on my account on the Bellingcat website. Once I was one of the contributors of the Bellingcat.
What is Bellingcat?
Bellingcat is a London-based team which is doing military investigations about Syria and Ukraine too. It's a more famous team than our team. They found my login and password on my profile on Bellingcat website with ability to make publications. And then they, using my credentials, they posted a post on the Bellingcat website with title "Cyber Bracket Follows You." Also they found in my mailbox a scan copy of my passport, home address, phone number, and they published it all. Since then, I started receiving phone calls with threats of violence over me. Well, I think it was... Later, Threat Connect found that hackers which attacked me were from Fancybear. This is my story, and that's all.
Thank you, Ruslan. Vadim, you work with activists and journalists in the region beyond Russia, but in the former Soviet Union. Can you tell us how similar or how different are attacks against these targets?
Right. I know very little about Russia. Well, relatively little about Russia. Most of what I know about Russia comes from these people. Also, I cannot talk. I will not be talking about myself. MIT, and I'm not very interesting. So I will be talking about other people. We've been observing the same type of attacks that Oleg has been describing, and that have repeatedly happened in Russia last year. The use of a local national mobile number to get access to people's online accounts, which are recoverable through a mobile number. That happened to him and another person. Before that, that happened to two people from Novaya Gazeta, an independent newspaper based in Russia. After that, most recently, it happened twice in January to two people from an election observation organization called GOLAS. Before March 2017, we haven't seen a similar attack elsewhere in the former Soviet Union. Until finally on the 24th of March, one day before a scheduled mass protest in Minsk, Belarus, two people who are like a family of one of the organizers of the protest reported that their Facebook accounts were hijacked, apparently using the same technique. And whoever hijacked those accounts was then encouraging people to not go out to the street and participate in the protest. So we've seen the same type of attack elsewhere. Now, attribution is really hard. In the case of online hacking. However, this is consistent with what a state-sponsored attacker would do, because there's basically no money in there to make, so that's not what cyber criminals usually do. Another interesting recent story from the former Soviet Union, and if you're interested, you should definitely check it up. It has been going on for a while, and a local researcher in Azerbaijan has been investigating it, but never published, because he lives locally, because he has a permanent job, et cetera, et cetera. So he has been collecting material, and then Amnesty International independently found, investigated, and published the same story. If you're interested, the report is called Fake Friends, How Fake Accounts and Crude Malware Targeted Dissidents in Azerbaijan. It came out on the 10th of March. Basically, in multiple times in 2016, most of the prominent human rights defenders in Azerbaijan received emails from email accounts that are very similar to the email accounts of their colleagues, co-workers, and friends, with like a one in the end. So almost the same thing, people don't notice that, that contained an attachment which dropped or installed a basic keylogger and screenshot utility on their computers, and a very basic email client, which regularly grabbed those screenshots and recorded key presses and sent them to a server. Now, we have seen three generations of those, of that file, so whoever worked on that improved it over time. It became much, much better over the course of 2015 and 2016. But the initial version didn't use a public email server, but instead used a private email server, which used an IP address which belongs to an IP address, to the address range which is usually used by the Ministry of Justice and Ministry of the Interior and several similar organizations. Azerbaijan, yeah, I'm talking about Azerbaijan. So, how fake accounts and crude malware targeted dissidents in Azerbaijan. I'm basically telling you that story. So, bottom line, activists and human rights defenders and dissidents in the neighboring countries, including Belarus and Azerbaijan, are targeted using the same basically the same technology. A combination of phishing, malware, and attacks against their online accounts using their national mobile phone numbers.
Thank you, Vadim. Eva, you investigated and researched such attacks in the past, and can you share with us your findings and maybe your recommendations?
Sure. So we've talked a little bit about Russia and our various bears, both fancy and cozy. And we've talked a little bit about Azerbaijan, and now I'm here to talk to you about Kazakhstan. So about a year and a half ago, maybe closer to 2 years ago, a large cache of leaks appeared on the internet, and it was called KazaLeaks. This was a series of, I think, hundreds of emails which were being published, and they were the emails between a company called Arcanum Intelligence, located in Zurich, Switzerland, a very, very high-end intelligence gathering company, and the government of Kazakhstan. As part of this discussion, they were talking about Arcanum providing services over a period of years, giving them intelligence on a sort of prominent political opponent of Kazakhstan's president, who had several years ago fled the country with his family and was had previously been in charge of a bank. And because he had become an enemy of the president, had had the bank essentially taken out from under him. Not content With having driven his political enemies out of the country, the president was in the process of suing this guy and also engaged in a number of lawsuits with members of his family, some of which had married into the family and were also prominent former politicians. Among other things, we learned that the government of Kazakhstan had paid Arcanum Intelligence almost $7 million in exchange for their services over a period of 2 years, and that these services had largely been provided by a former director of internal intelligence, local intelligence from France. I think he had worked for President Sarkozy around 2012 and had since gone into sort of private service in Switzerland. So obviously this was a bunch of very juicy information, and Kazakhstan's sort of one remaining independent online newspaper, Respublika, located of course well outside of Kazakhstan, started to report on it. Respublika's web servers at the time were located in the state of New York, and the government of Kazakhstan immediately filed a lawsuit against whoever it was that was publishing this stuff, and while they did not name Respublika, it looked like they thought that Respublika was responsible. And this is how the Electronic Frontier Foundation became Respublika's lawyers. So one of the things that we started doing was we started to defend this like small independent Kazakh newspaper from accusations of having published, I think it was stolen materials. Now, shortly after we became their lawyers, the editors of the paper started getting suspicious phishing emails. Now, unlike most law firms, the Electronic Frontier Foundation also has as part of the organization, a branch that does nothing but security research, and I am in charge of it. So they went ahead, they forwarded them to me, which is something that most law firms don't get to do, and I began an analysis. I started by collecting the emails which were being sent to our clients, then to friends of our clients, then to their associates, then to other dissidents, which were sort of prominently opposed to the current president of Kazakhstan, and I discovered a few things in the course of my analysis, along with my colleagues. We were able to trace many of these emails back to a source in India. Furthermore, we were able to find overlaps in the command and control infrastructure that was being used by the malware being dropped in these phishing emails. We found an overlap with another campaign, which had been reported on the year before, called Operation Hangover by a security company called Norman Shark. Operation Hangover was about an actor that had been going after sort of industrial targets in India, as well as some, I think, Punjabi separatists. So it looked very much like an Indian actor. And Norman Shark pinned this whole thing on an actor called Apin, which is a company based, I think, out of New Delhi, that does, that supposedly trains systems administrators and offers a certified ethical hacking certificate, but in fact does hacking for hire. It is sometimes very difficult to pick them up as an actor because they are so noisy, because they do so much work. It's kind of hard to tell what's them and what's not them, because unlike Cozy Bear and Fancy Bear, they're not hitting the same sorts of targets over and over and over again. But fortunately for us, what they are doing is reusing infrastructure, because hackers are lazy. So we went ahead and we published this report last year. We presented it at Black Hat Security in August. Some of the attacks stopped, some of the CNCs went down, but phishing emails have continued, and nearly everyone that we've talked to continues to, we think, be targeted by the government of Kazakhstan. So let me talk really quickly about sort of what kind of phishing emails these were. Because in that sense, what they're seeing is very similar to what you're seeing in Russia and Azerbaijan, which is to say that they would get emails that looked like they were coming from somebody that they knew. So in that case, they were a little bit not like Russia. Russia liked to send sort of fake Google password resets. But in this case, they were sort of trying to take advantage of the web of trust. So you get an email that looks like it's coming from somebody you know. Sometimes it is a fake Gmail address, or say mail.ru address, that looks like it's very close to your friend, only with some sort of typo. But occasionally, they would simply compromise another person in your network of trust and then send emails, phishing emails, from that person's email account. And they were usually coming in the form of press releases, promises of compromising information about the government of Kazakhstan, which would obviously be very interesting to dissidents. And because they were frequently targeting lawyers and spokespeople, they were also invoices and supposed legal documents. So anytime you opened one of these, it would covertly install malware on your computer. That malware was actually really cheap. They were installing two very, very popular rats called Badook and JRAT. I think you can actually purchase JRAT for something like 55 euro. So state spying, not very expensive, in case you were looking. So they were buying these cheap rats. They're installing the cheap rats on activists' computers, and they would exfiltrate that information back to these command and control servers that were also being used to spy on people who had absolutely nothing to do with Kazakhstan, and who were being, where they were paying to spy on these people, they were getting money from other clients. Attribution, as most people in the security industry will tell you, is hard. And weirdly tricky, so I do not have a smoking gun telling you that this is absolutely what went on. But one extremely plausible theory of what happened, why there is evidence that the government of Kazakhstan gave Arcanum a lot of money, but this Indian company appears to have done the hacking, is graft. So the government of Kazakhstan hands $7 million to Arcanum. Arcanum turns around, subcontracts it out to India, pockets the rest of the money. So this is my theory right now. I can talk a little bit about mitigations, unless you want to go around again. Shall we do mitigations?
Yes, please.
All right. So I want to talk a little bit about what you do if you're being targeted by these things, because as you can see, we're seeing the same themes show up over and over and over again. People are getting phishing emails, people are having their two-factor SMS intercepted, people are taking advantage of the web of trust. And so there are a couple of things that everybody can do that would really help. One is to familiarize yourself with phishing. Know what a phishing email looks like, so that you know not to click on it in the first place. This is the best way of avoiding putting malware on your computer. The next suggestion is that everybody use a password safe of some sort. I usually recommend 1Password. For this purpose, and the reason that I recommend it is because it also has some anti-phishing capability. So not only are your passwords unique and long and strong for every one of your many logins, but if you try to enter your password in a domain that doesn't match this account, it simply won't copy. So that's sort of their anti-phishing protection. I strongly recommend this. I think it would be a good idea. It would prevent a lot of the compromises that we've seen. And finally, if the platform that you're using has a non-SMS-based two-factor, I very strongly recommend that you use it. I think we really cannot trust SMS-based two-factors if we are, dealing with attackers from Russia or the post-Soviet states. And it's time to stop pretending that these things are safe. And my very last piece of advice, especially for people working in the post-Soviet regions and most of all in Russia, is not to trust the Russian companies. So move your mail off of mail.ru, move your stuff off of Yandex, don't make your secret plans for your campaign on ВКонтакте. Just assume that this is all compromised and move to platforms that are located outside of Russia. I don't even care what it is, just outside of Russia is a very good start. Also outside of Kazakhstan and Azerbaijan and all of these things. So just get the hell out of the post-Soviet states.
Estonia is fine.
Also Latvia. For as long as they're not part of the Russian Federation, which I expect to be. Like. For now, they're fine.
Thank you, Eva. We are now ready to open the floor for your comments, questions, and interventions. Please keep them short. If you would like to introduce yourself, please do so. Yes, please. Do we have anyone handing the microphone?
Okay, my name is Alexandra Eriksson, and I'm a journalist at EU Observer here in Brussels, and I have two questions. One is that now there is a lot of fear in the EU about Russia and about interference in elections and so on, and overall people are very afraid, and I'm wondering if you see any possibilities for stronger relations, cooperation or something between you and EU actors to try to work together against Russian government's interference. And the second question was, so the EU is also revising its regulation on export controls, and I'm wondering if any of the surveillance systems used that has been targeting you has been EU made? I guess not.
So, export controls in the EU will have almost zero effect on the market inside of Russia and the post-Soviet states. If this is how you're trying to fix the problem, it's simply not going to work. The Russian government likes to roll its own. Nearly all of the things that they're using are built at home by Russians with a full-time staff that comes in the morning, tries to hack people all day, and then goes home at night. This is not true of some of the post-Soviet states such as Kazakhstan, but as you can see, what they did was none of the software they were using was built inside of the EU or sold from the EU. Instead, they hired a company in the EU that turned around and hired a company in India, and even that Indian company did not buy software from anybody. They just went ahead and did all of the hacking themselves. Mostly they're using very free and cheap tools, and there is no export of tools from Europe directly to Russia or from Europe directly to Kazakhstan. So that's really not the right place to make this sort of interference. I'm also extremely skeptical about the use of export controls in order to have any kind of effect on this market. I work for the Electronic Frontier Foundation. We are the people who got the ruling in the United States that code is speech, and I believe that very strongly. There is a feeling inside of the EU that because activists are being targeted and journalists are being targeted, and this is a great tragedy, that we must do something, and this is something, and therefore it must be done. But when you decide to do this sort of intervention, you really need to think about whether or not it's going to have a sort of knock-on effects on the ability of security researchers such as myself to do the work, and you need to think about whether or not your solution is actually going to solve the problem at hand, which in this case, it will not.
And maybe I will add something about the first question. So totally agree that Russian governmental hackers are effective and pretty dangerous in European countries too, because We've heard about the activities in most of European countries already, such as Italy, Germany, Great Britain, Sweden, Hungary, Poland, Ukraine, of course, all the Baltic states. I'm not sure about Spain and Portugal, but well, almost all of the European countries, sometimes officially, like from the government, as Germany, for example, Poland, Baltic states, sometimes like there were like personal allegations, like for example, Emmanuel Macron, who is opponent of Le Pen, who is also Kremlin-supported candidate now. So yes, this is a very hot topic, but I actually don't know how people who from Russia are now watching this can cooperate with the European Union, because actually this threat is already pretty well known. It's information about that is published. So the only one thing that can be done, I think, is just raising awareness of what already known to make politicians more attentive about what emails they're opening, and to and I think security services of all these countries are already cooperating between each other. At least they say so. So I'm not sure that we can add something to that.
Thank you. Yes.
Hello, my name is Samat. I have a question for you, Eva.
Yes?
You said that you were collecting and phishing emails from your clients' friends, etc. I think for me, it's the hard part is teaching my clients to identify those phishing emails. How did you manage to do that for the friends of your clients? I mean, that's a pretty huge list of people, it should be.
Well, there are a couple of things that I do. The first is that EFF publishes a security and privacy guide called Surveillance Self-Defense, which includes a section on phishing and malware and sort of how you identify these things and what do you do once you've gotten them. And there's some discussion of state-sponsored malware in that section. But there's a limited amount of help that you can get out of that, because it only exists for the people who have gone through the trouble of looking at surveillance self-defense. I think that awareness raising and outreach is one of the most important parts of my job. I travel all around the world talking to people in vulnerable populations and trying to convince them that, you know, show them galleries of other phishing emails so that they know what to look for, and then encourage them when they are targeted by these phishing emails, not to just sit on them or delete them, which is also a thing that happens because people become very uncomfortable with this mail on in their inbox, and they think that it is dangerous just sitting there. So they don't know what to do with it, and they delete it, and maybe they tell me about it 6 months later, which is not very helpful. So I have an entire slide deck of things that I show them, both to help them identify the phishing and also to tell them how to properly send the phishing to me in a way that is useful. Some examples of things that are not useful. Do not send me a screenshot of the attachment. There's usually a very long part of the conversation in which I have to explain to somebody how to send full mail headers. Sometimes I have to explain to them why it's very important for them to send me the mail as soon as possible, because most phishing campaigns will only last a few days or a week. And so I have a very limited window of time in which to actually pull down the malware, which is the part that I would like to analyze so that I can see how this is linked to other campaigns and other people who are being targeted. And frequently the people who are being targeted don't know that there is something that they can do. And they don't know that they could contribute to the knowledge about how these actors work. And so they don't reach out to anyone. They just silently delete it. Or they tell me a year later that something happened. So that's really the thing that I've been trying to change over the last couple of years. And if RightsCon is any indication, we've made some progress, but there's definitely still a long way to go.
Also, usually the amount of efforts people are going to put into the mitigation is directly proportional to the perceived impact of the incident. So if people think that something really, really, really bad may happen to them or their friends if they miss a phishing email, they're usually more motivated than others.
So scare them?
Or let them scare one another. It works better.
Please, lady on the in the center, near the aisle.
Can I take a moment to push back against the notion that we should be scaring people? Scaring people is really satisfying because you get to feel very powerful. But in my experience as an InfoSec trainer, it doesn't work. People who are scared become paralyzed. One of the things that works best for me, and again, my methods are not 100% successful by any stretch of the imagination, is to make people feel empowered. Like when they send me a phishing email, not only can they avoid having their account compromised and they can avoid having bad things happen to their sources and their friends, but they're also helping me with my research. They are empowered, and I will produce a report, and I will tell you who is behind this and what the other victims are, and possibly we can file a lawsuit, or we can picket the company, or we can get on the front page of the New York Times, that they are part of a much larger story and I need their help. That is the thing that works for me, and scaring people generally doesn't.
Thank you. Can you pass the mic? We don't have a special person who's supposed to do this.
Hello. So given the amount of hacking that has been in the news in political causes in the United States, and given that the fact is most political organizers are fresh out of college, have no experience with this, have no organizational training, are there resources that you have for novices entering a space that might be vulnerable to hacking and have no experience, so that similar to the, you know, the sexual harassment training that you go through at your first job, is there a don't get hacked phishing protection for new hires type program?
Nodding silently.
Okay. I recommend surveillance self-defense, which you can get to at ssd.eff.org. It is translated into a number of languages, including Russian and Arabic, and also Amharic, which is the sort of native language of Ethiopia. So I think we have something like 8 different languages right now, but we're trying to really aim it at especially vulnerable populations. There, rather than reading the entire contents of surveillance self-defense, which is very long, we have these things called playlists in which we've sort of identified the top 5 or 6 things that we think people need to know when they're starting out in security. And one of those playlists is specifically an activist playlist and talks about what it is that activists need to think about when they're doing their work. I am not sure exactly how effective this is, because I think that most people don't wake up in the morning and decide that they're going to be activists. I think most people become activists by accident, and you wake up one morning and suddenly you're an activist, and you didn't decide to set up a pseudonym online, and you've already revealed a bunch of stuff about yourself, and you haven't protected your family, and then now what? So I think that's really the discussion that we should be having when it comes to educating activists and helping them to protect themselves.
Thank you.
So I have actually 2 questions, but very quick. They're mostly technical. First is, you mentioned some slide decks you have on, like, this is how phishing emails look like. Are they public?
Not at this time, but EFF is working on a trainer's hub. Many people in the last few months, for some strange reason, from the security industry have suddenly decided that perhaps they should go out into civil society and teach people how to protect themselves online. And so EFF has been working on a project in which we help people understand what it takes to become a security trainer, talk about sort of the big meta problems, but also provide them with some sample curricula and some slide decks that they can use in their training. And I am hoping that my gallery of phishing will be part of this, as well as the slide deck that I use in training people to identify phishing and malware.
This is work in progress and not published yet, right?
This is currently a work in progress and it is not yet published.
Thank you.
Stay tuned.
Gentleman in the last row.
Hmm? had two questions.
Can we pass the mic to the other person and you can return with to your question a bit later? Thank you.
Thank you. I'm Bogdan from Romania. And in the Western countries especially, but also in the Eastern ones, in the past, let's say 1 year, there's been a total paranoia about internet, about Russian hackers and e-voting. And I would ask you to comment that a bit, or if you have any kind of internet voting or e-voting in Russia and you had cases on that. And also related, if you are knowledgeable that Russia is active on the market of buying zero-day exploits, or you've seen certain ways that they have been used.
When we're passing by.
Sorry? Yeah, I'll give you my email. And the second question you mentioned about mitigation, isn't also a solution in case of phishing to use Linux, maybe?
Linux?
How? How would that work? If you're interested in a hacking story involving electronic voting in Russia, there has been a major incident involving the, what was it called? No. The independent, the democracy. The Coordination Council of the Opposition, whose server has been hacked and.
It was a different story. I have to correct you. It was a primary organized by one of the opposition parties called Parnas, and they had a serious breach of security, to put it so, weeks before the actual voting took place. And so their list of voters had leaked, as well as their passwords. And somebody managed to cast quite a few fake votes, which basically invalidated much of the procedure. It was not an official election, not organized by the government, and yet it had a direct relation to the official election because they were selecting their candidates for the State Duma.
You should look it up. The Google search would be something like Russia Democratic Coalition primary hack catastrophe, or something like that. Then Linux is not going to help you against any kind of attacks on your online accounts because the choice of the operating system is irrelevant to in an inefficient scenario. What was the third one? Whether Russia is hoarding 0 days? Probably, but then everybody is. I mean, we're in 2017. That's how it works. Some people have some governments have more money than others, but it seems that everybody is doing it. But then again, I have no special knowledge about it. I have this exactly the same internet access and read exactly the same Intercept, Motherboard, and EFF, and all of those websites as you do.
To add on Linux, I think one of the problems is that it's even really, really hard often to force an activist to use Gmail instead of Yandex, and it's next to impossible to force them to replace their Windows PC for a Linux computer.
But so even if we do, it doesn't help.
Yeah, even if it helped, we wouldn't do it. yes.
The mic guy, I will squeeze
okay,
my questions.
You hijacked the mic again, okay.
You mentioned that there is a procedure like people being phished, sending you the phishing emails and you analyzing them. Is there any platform, I mean, the inbox where these phishing emails could be sent to be analyzed? Is there any progress on this field?
Well, you know what I should do? I should have Rob answer this one. Yes? I'll give him the mic.
So over the past few weeks, I've been working on what is now going to be an open source project for submitting phishing attacks, emails, and such things. And, hi. I'll be working with Internews to get it put out on GitHub, and anyone will be able to deploy basically a box for collecting phishing emails and attacks.
Can we find it?
So I will probably coordinate with Eva to, you know, talk about it and internews as well. So whatever the URL is for the GitHub will be coming soon. So
thank you. Then we have time for two last questions, I think. The lady in the first row.
Are you aware if Russia is helping any other or capacitating any other countries in order that they learn how to do this? Because in South America, at least in Ecuador, we have all the things. I have been hacked, my emails published. I have been tampered with my cell phone. I am part of pack rat investigation and name it. Our government contracted hacking team. So, but sometimes we think that there is like a book of bad practices and that they are sharing, and I don't know who was the first one and who is sharing the book of bad practices, but in Latin America we have had all that thing. It sounds like home. So that's what I wonder, if we can, because you talk something like Big Bear, I don't remember how much, and some people seems to be outsourcing the hacking, and some people have seems to have their own hackers at home, and I don't know if you are aware that it's a world trend, and that they are presidents that befriend each other, and they are. Sometimes they visit one each other, and then you see something that was happening in your country, happening in your country, then happens in the next country. So I don't know if you're aware of this. I'm just asking because since I have been here, I have heard people from Africa complaining about this. People from Ecuador, we complain about this. I have heard people from Russia complaining about the same things.
Well, if you're asking whether or not people from law enforcement and the government in the post-Soviet states all, say, travel to Russia in order to get trained in the same way that this happens in Latin America, I think in Colombia, the answer is we don't know. We don't have a lot of any evidence that I'm aware of that this particular thing is happening. But governments do inspire one another. If you see that your neighbor is able to get the capability to spy on their dissidents, and you don't like your dissidents, and you want to know what they're up to, and you would like to send somebody to Europe to kidnap their families and take them back to your capital, then you just ask them, hey, what are you using? Or you wait for one of our reports. Or you get approached by a company like Hacking Team or Killer Mobile or NSO, and they say, would you like to have this special capability? And you go, how much does it cost? And then the answer is $200,000. And you say, why, that's pocket change for a crazy authoritarian state such as my own. I think that it is more likely that things happen in that way than that they are all going to Russia to get trained. Especially since most of the post-Soviet states don't seem to be deploying Russian malware, and they don't seem to be deploying malware that they are building themselves. They are mostly outsourcing this problem.
And the last question, please.
Hello. My name is Salman. I'm an information security analyst at Mailfence. I would like to ask the Russian journalists, which we have here in the panel. Yes. We have seen cyber espionage before. We have seen governments hacking each other for their personal gains. But now we have seen cases like people precisely being killed because their devices have been hacked. And this has been seen recently in case of Ukraine, where Russia actually hacked a telecommunication provider, and actually traced down the location of the soldiers and passed on that information to the Russian soldiers who carry on and killed those soldiers. So there is new thing going on, which we see as cyber warfare in this whole area. My question to yourself is, within Russia, what are the role of local organizations and journalists and activists over there? How do they see this whole scenario? What are they doing about it? And the second part of the question is, in this whole era, where we see Russia as a place where all these high-tech attacks gets planned and take place for a particular enemy. What are the local people, local masses, public organizations are doing against it? For example, they are also being targeted from time to time, as you mentioned previously. So what are they doing? And on the other side, the journalist and the activist, how do they see this situation where we have the cyber warfare and people are killing, people are being killed just because their locations has been tracked and passed on to the soldiers? Thank you.
On the one hand, I agree with you that this is, actually I see the picture the same as you do, but I don't think that we can view it in terms of like rule of law institutions and or such institutions as journalists and, I don't know, human rights watchers as some actors in this game, because they can be viewed as victims of the same crimes. But there is nothing that we can really do, at least because even without any hackers, the government already kills Russian journalists, Russian activists, both inside country and outside the country. They even don't need hackers for that. So what can we do in the case when we are not defended on our own? And on the previous section, they discussed governmental hacking in the sense of what Western countries do to, like, to interfere in, I don't know, different gadgets and to spy and so on. And they discussed mostly some legal things or what civil society can do. In the case of Russia, we even don't have any kind of discussion, because it's evident that we can only try to defend ourselves and to be more loud, to explain others what's going on. That's the only thing that we can do. But that's not like, you know, we can write a big investigation about FSB, and FSB stops doing that. The result is that FSB comes after you. That often happens, and that we of course will keep doing that, and they will keep going after us, so that we are not afraid, of course. But still, we shouldn't think that this practice can stop by civil society or journalists. And even the foreign actors, because as we both understand, that it's a violation also not only Russian law, but international law, both in Ukraine and both, of course, and in the case of United States, it's all actually can be even seen as foreign aggression. But as we see, they even are not afraid of it already. So we even have to think, and what all the world community can do in legal sphere to stop this and to protect themselves.
This is a hard question, and I'm afraid we have run out of our time. Thank you very much for attending this panel. Thank you for speaking here.